Welcome to NOAA Live Alaska. My name is Lisa Keenricky-Raring, and I'm going to be moderating today's webinar. This series is a collaborative effort by NOAA Fisheries Alaska Fisheries Science Center, where I work, NOAA's Alaska Regional Collaboration Network, and NOAA's National Weather Service. I also wanted to introduce my co-coordinator, Mabel Baldwin-Schaefer, who will be helping me behind the scenes. This webinar series is designed to help you get to know NOAA's work in Alaska, our partners, and the communities we work with in Alaska, and how we connect with your communities. NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, studies the ocean and the atmosphere and where the two meet, from weather to ocean to the animals that live around us. This school year, we're presenting short series of webinars that are more regionally based so that we can focus on topics of interest to those regions of Alaska. We were aiming to present perspectives from the communities we work with, as well as the research conducted by students, in addition to established scientists. We hope this gives you a look at different communities as well as different career paths you might be interested in. Today, we're welcoming Vanessa Lowe, Pam Goddard, and Hannah Miller. Vanessa and Pam work for Linker Technologies for the NOAA Fisheries Alaska Fisheries Science Center, and Hannah Miller is an intern with the NOAA DeepSea Coral Research and Technology Program and just graduated from Emory University. While we'll be talking about NOAA's role in research and stewardship, we want to recognize that we're all coming to you from the traditional lands of Native communities who have substantial Indigenous knowledge and much to share with us. In Alaska, the data that Pam, Vanessa, and Hannah work with is collected in the Bering Sea, Aleutian Islands, Gulf of Alaska, and Southeast Alaska, which are the traditional home waters of the Inupiaq, Yupik, Siberian Yupik, Inungak, Aleutic Siupiaq, Iyak, Tlingit, Haida, and Tsimshian peoples. We'd like to acknowledge that Pam is presenting from Eastham, Massachusetts, the traditional lands of the Nauset tribe. Vanessa is presenting from El Segundo, California, located within the traditional lands of the Tongva Nation. Hannah is presenting from Atlanta, Georgia, on the land of the Muscogee Creek peoples, and we're hosting the webinar from the traditional lands of the Coast Salish peoples, including the first people of Seattle, the Duwamish people, past and present. Mabel is joining us from Benta, Wasilla, the ancestral lands of the Dena'ina and Otna peoples. And these peoples have been stewards of their traditional homelands and waters for thousands of years. A few guidelines before I hand you over to our speakers. You're all muted because we have a lot of people on the line and we want to make sure everyone can hear our speaker. However, there's a box where you can write questions and we encourage you to ask them as we go. And my colleague Mabel and I will be keeping track behind the scenes. We'll stop every now and then and answer a few questions. We may not get to all of our questions, but we'll try to answer as many as we can. Okay. I'm going to hand it over to Vanessa to introduce herself.
Hello, everyone. My name is Vanessa Lowe, and before we talk about the deep sea, I'd like to tell you a little bit about how I first got interested in marine science. As a kid growing up by the beach in California, I was totally fascinated by the tide pools there. So in high school, I volunteered at an aquarium and where they let me work on a science fair project working on jellyfish, which really steered my desire to study marine biology in college. So I moved to Washington State to go to school and got a summer job there as a field assistant that took me camping and kayaking in Canada and Alaska, which really fueled my interest in field work. After college, I got a job with NOAA Fisheries doing lab work in Seattle and field work on boats in Alaska. So I got to travel to a bunch of new places like Nome, Dutch Harbor, and St. Paul Island. Last year, I started a new work on coral and sponges. So we'll talk about some of that today. I'm really excited to talk to you today about the deep sea in Alaska. We'll talk about the animals that live there, the habitat in the deep, and the research we're doing to learn more about this vast but underexplored part of the Earth. Then Pam will tell you a bit about the technology and equipment that we use to study the deep sea. And finally, Hannah will share with you her experience as a student intern for the Deep Sea Coral Research Technology Program. So I want you to take a minute and imagine yourself on the coast of Alaska, looking out on the ocean, but you're going to travel hundreds or even thousands of feet under the surface of the water to the bottom of the ocean. What might it look like and how do you think you'd get there? Well, to get that deep, you might need to get on a boat that's equipped with a submersible that looks like this one. You'd climb in the top, seal it tight, and look out a porthole as you descend to the deep. You'd start at the surface, and as you descend, maybe you'd see a scuba diver, but only down to about 200 feet, because that's the limit of standard scuba gear. For today, the depth and deeper is what we'll consider the deep sea, but understand that different programs have different definitions. As you descend further down in the water column, you might see jellyfish like this one or some fish. And then you'll notice that at about 600 feet that it becomes very dark. And that's because this is the limit that sunlight can penetrate the ocean water. But safe and dry in your submersible, you can go even deeper down to a limit of about 1200 feet in this type. Newer models can go even deeper. So what does the seafloor in Alaska look like? Well, it's very dark and cold, and it may look sandy like this, but the bottom type can vary greatly. It could have pebbles or cobbles, large boulders, or a mix of all of them. Alternatively, the seafloor could be solid bedrock. But what kinds of animals do you think live in these environments? There are a lot of different types that you probably already know, including octopus, skates, snails, shrimp, sea stars, and even some that you might like to eat, like halibut, rockfish, and crab. But there are some very special animals that not only live here in the deep, but also make it a better place for other animals to live and thrive. They include corals and sponges. They're both sessile creatures, which means that they attach to the surface and can't move from that spot for their entire adult life. They both come in many different shapes and sizes and colors, but they do have some differences too, so let's check that out. We'll start with corals. Corals are mostly colonial, and they're made up of small polyps that use tentacles to acquire their food, like these in this picture. Since they can't move from their spot, they need to use these tentacles to grab food floating by in the water, like zooplankton or even brine shrimp. Corals produce a skeleton that's made out of calcium carbonate, like the material that seashells are made out of. The coral can be soft or hard depending on the form of the skeleton. So for soft corals, like this one in the picture, the skeleton is made up of these tiny, spiny plates called sclerites, and that allows the coral more flexibility. Hard corals that you might think of in the tropics lay down the skeletal material in layers to create hard skeletons that can build up into reefs. But most of the corals in Alaska are these more flexible soft corals. Some of them like soft bottom, like these sea pens and sea whips, because they're able to attach by penetrating the sand or mud bottom. But most of the corals in Alaska prefer to attach to hard surfaces, like these soft coral examples that are attached to boulders and hard bottom. There are about 150 coral species that we know of in Alaska. And if you'd like to learn more about these animals, you can check out our NOAA Live presentation from last year on YouTube. We'll provide some links to different information at the end. So now let's take a look at sponges. They are also sessile animals that attach to surfaces for their adult life, but they're very different from corals. Their skeletons can be made up of different types of materials. For example, glass sponges, like these two that are circled in blue, are made up of silica or glass-like particles. Here's a close-up of what that might look like. While demosponges, like the one circled in orange, are made of siliceous spicules as well as spongin fibers. But most of what we see in the deep are glass and demosponges like these ones. There are more than 200 species in Alaska, and they can be soft or rock-like. Some are encrusting, some stand tall, but most of them attach to hard surfaces. So instead of actively catching food out of the water, like corals, most of them filter water through their bodies. The water is filtered in one direction from the outside of the sponge through their body and out the hole in the middle, as shown in these arrows. By doing this, they can sift food out of the water, including plankton, bacteria, and dissolved organic material that is sank from above. But they filter a lot of water. It's been estimated that sponges can filter 10,000 times their own volume of water in just one day. So I want to ask you a question. If we as humans could do this same thing, how much water do you think that that would be in gallons? Can you take a guess?
So for those of you in our audience, if you as a human were like a sponge and you filtered water at the same rate that a sponge does, how much water do you think, how many gallons of water do you think that you would filter through your body? So put your guess into the question box and let's see what you guys are thinking. We've got a couple of people who are, so Ronan is asking in one day or in an hour? So are we talking one day? So, okay, Linda is estimating 100 gallons. Alice and Paul are estimating actually about 140,000. Carol is saying 1,000. Michael is saying 50 gallons. Ronan is saying 50 gallons. So it looks like we're all over the board here, although we go from 50 gallons all the way up to 140,000. So Vanessa, what do you think? How many gallons would a human filter.
Well, it's not 16 or 160, but 160,000 gallons. So one of you was very close, actually.
And that's wow.
Of five backyard swimming pools.
That is pretty incredible. So I had no idea that sponges filter that much water.
So does anybody have any questions about corals or sponges so far? We'll talk some more about them in a couple minutes.
Yeah, so if you have any questions about corals or sponges that came up as we were going through that, all of the really cool pictures that Vanessa was showing us, please feel free to put your questions into the question box. We did have a question about, you were talking about sponges and some of them were called glass sponges. Mm-hmm. Is that because of the shape of the sponge, or does that have to do with what the sponge is made up of?
It's because of the material that they're made up of. So that's like glass-like particles that are all sort of together in a certain format, and that determines how the shape of those sponges will look. But the material is glass.
Oh, that's very interesting. So Allison Paul are asking, how do they reproduce?
You know, let's move on from that, and we can address it at the end, just so we can get moving forward a little bit with the rest of the talk. Is that okay?
Yeah, I think that's a little bit complicated, so I can understand why you might want to.
We'll
come back to that question, and we'll come back to it. So just hold tight to that one.
We'll move forward with the next section, and then we can come back.
But we do have a question about filtering. Linda was wondering, how are they filtering? So I'm assuming that she's talking about the sponges. So how do sponges filter? What's the mechanism of how they filter?
They have special cells inside them that create a flow that only goes one direction, that are lined up inside the body of the whole body of the sponge. And so those special cells move it from the outside through the inside and then back out the hole. There's also more complicated formats too, but that's kind of the more basic setup.
And then Michael was wondering, can sponges plug up if they're filtering all that stuff?
You know, I don't know.
That's a good question. Maybe that's something to research on the internet. And so Michelle had a question about the warmth of the water, because she's from Hawaii, so I'm sure that she's probably familiar with warm water corals. We're talking mm-hmm. about deep sea corals here, right? So how warm does the water need to be for corals to exist? Is there some kind of range, or because it must be pretty cold at the bottom?
In Alaska, it's really cold. I'm not sure as much about the warm water sponges, I would think that they have a really large range of water temperatures, just since they live in all these different oceans and different depths as well. But these ones live really deep and cold, so they're mostly cold water sponges.
And that actually brings up another question of when we're talking about deep sea corals, how deep is deep?
Well, so it depends on what kind of research people are doing. For the purpose of the coral group that we work for, we look at about 50 meters as a cutoff, which is about 160 feet. So when we were talking about the depth of a scuba diver goes, is about 200 feet. So we are kind of determining that deep is deeper than that. But like the Aleutian Trench in Alaska is 25,000 feet deep. So it's a very big range.
Right. Well, we do have a couple more questions, but I know that you had wanted to talk about habitat a little bit. So maybe we'll go ahead and go into our next section, because I think that some of these questions might be answered from that.
Sure. Okay. So we've talked a little bit about corals and sponges separately, but why are they both so special? So imagine you're a fish living near the seafloor. What kinds of things are you concerned about? If you're thinking about maybe hiding from predators, feeding, laying eggs, then you're exactly right. Sponges and corals can help with all of these things because they provide additional structure and stability to the seafloor and create what we call habitat. So this is to support spawning and feeding grounds, nursery areas, as well as providing places to hide from predators. Because they have so many different shapes and some stand tall off the bottom, they create a lot of three-dimensional space that's complex, so we refer to them as structure-forming invertebrates. So let's check out a few examples that show how corals and sponges provide habitat and community structure. So our first example is feeding. So in these pictures, we can see how coral and sponge help other animals get better access to food. They provide a structure for the animal to climb up higher in the water column to get access to other prey, to seek like seeking a high perch or using them as a platform. Some types of sea stars also feed directly on both corals and sponges. Our next example is shelter or places to hide. In these examples, you might notice a number of fish that are associated with the coral and sponge, but if you look close, you can see them hiding underneath the sponge or right inside the hole. Some fish even lay their eggs right inside sponges to protect them from predators. Plus, there's an added bonus because sponges have natural antibacterial and antifungal properties that potentially benefit the eggs. Another benefit is camouflage. So in these examples, the fish are not only hiding, but they are a bit camouflaged as their color is similar to the sponge or coral that they're associated with. In the bottom left picture, did you notice that the little black dots that are on the coral polyps, so like right here and right here, those are actually the eyes of larval fish hiding amongst the coral. So you can see their little body going right here. So how about another camouflage challenge? In this bed of anemones, sponges, and hydrocorals, there are some baby rockfish hiding. How many fish do you think you can find in this picture?
So for our audience, if you look very carefully at the picture, see whether you can guess how many fish or count how many fish there are. It's a little tricky. It reminds me of one of those puzzles where you're trying to look in between and beyond. So put your put the number that you think you see into the question box, and we'll see what people are seeing when they are looking at the picture. So you can either put in the A, B, C, D, or you can put the number 1, 2, 4, or 6. So I'm seeing that Michael is saying C, which is 4. Carol is saying B, which is 2. Kim is saying 6. Ronan is saying 4. Laura is saying 4. Linda is saying 2. Carlene is saying 2. Michelle is saying 4. Louisa is saying 6. And Jasper is saying 4. So it looks like we have nobody saying 1. So that's good. But we've got a lot of people who are voting for either 2, 4, or 6. So can you tell us the answer, Vanessa?
Yeah, sorry, I'm fighting with this little I don't know how to get rid of it. That's okay. With the little laser pointer. Okay. Yes. So there's actually 6 in this picture. So you may have seen these 2 right off the bat. They're a little bit less hidden, but there's these 4 more sort of around the edges. You can sort of see, like in this one, there you can see his little eyes, and over here you can see a stripe on his back. So it's they're pretty sneaky though.
I would not have seen those 4. So I think I would have been one of the people to say 2. Yeah, they're very hidden.
Yeah. So finally, an added benefit of sponges is nutrient cycling. So that's great, right? Nutrient cycling, but what does that mean? Well, do you remember a little bit ago, we learned about how sponges filter a lot of water every day to get their food. By doing this, they are also recycling the ocean's waste. So think of all the small particles of waste that sink down to the deep from the water above. Instead of it all accumulating on the seafloor, sponges filter this material out and transfer nutrients from the water column to the seafloor community and help keep the ocean balanced and healthy. So this is really important for Alaska and the world's oceans too, because oceans make up 70% of the Earth's surface. So if sponges were removed, imagine what kind of waste would be accumulating on the seafloor. Because these animals are really important to the whole deep sea community, it is a priority to understand what different physical threats can damage them. Do you have any ideas what kind of physical harm they could affect them?
So if you have any ideas of what might threaten coral and sponge habitat or their lives really, put your ideas into the question box and we'll read off what we hear. So Linda is saying that fishing gear might be one threat. And I think that there's another idea that's coming up. Laura is saying bacteria. Let's see, we've got some folks that are talking about the temperature of the water, that maybe as the water warms, that might threaten coral and sponge habitat. So what do you think, Vanessa? Oh, we got one more. Carol's saying harmful algae. So what do you think, Vanessa? What kind of things might we have? We have another couple of votes for acidification and pollution.
Sure. And those are all great ideas, but I was thinking of kind of more direct physical threats. So things like marine debris or derelict fishing gear. You can see in this picture, you've got, lines and nets that are from fishing gear. Also, certain types of fishing can damage them. But also like energy and resource operations like oil and gas and anchored wind farms and deep sea mining that can affect the seafloor and the structure forming invertebrates that live there. So considering physical threats to corals and sponges is really important because these animals grow very slowly. Some types of coral could take as long as 100 years to grow as tall as you. So clearly protecting coral and sponge habitat is important for many different animals' homes, health, and the fisheries that they support. But what can we do to protect them? The first step is to understand more about them through research. So as I mentioned before, the research group that I work with is called the DeepSea Coral Research Technology Program. So it is a national group that was established to coordinate research on deep-sea corals and sponges in all regions of the United States. Including the Northeast and Southeast regions on the East Coast, as well as the Pacific Islands, West Coast, and Alaska, as you can see on this map. So each of these regions will work on projects for 3 years at a time, doing fieldwork and other studies to better understand where corals and sponges live and how to protect them from habitat destruction. So there is always work being done in the United States on these animals, but right now the work is focused in Alaska. We also did fieldwork and research in 2012 to 2014. And during these years, we completed many different projects, but the main focus was to understand where corals and sponges live and what bottom types they like in two main regions, the orange colored area there that is the Bering Sea slope and the Aleutian Islands that's marked in a darker pink color. From this work, we found that the highest density of coral and sponge is found in the Aleutians and We developed predictive models to best determine where these animals are likely to be found. This is important because not all locations can be explored given the immensity of Alaska. But this year we'll be focusing on the Gulf of Alaska, the area that's marked in the lighter pink. During the last initiative, we also created a coral guide, and that can be used in the field to identify corals in Alaska. It has pictures of the different corals, descriptions, and maps that show regions in Alaska that they have been found. And it's also free to the public and is available online. So there'll be a link at the end. So next, Pam will talk a bit about the research expeditions that will be going on next month and how we conduct this research.
We do have a couple of questions. And actually, what you were just talking about with the density of corals. Carol had wondered how close together do they grow, and you had mentioned that there were some areas that had higher densities than others. And so I was wondering whether you could talk a little bit about the density of corals and sponges.
Sure. So it's really variable. Like there's some areas where you'll see just a few, and then in some of the areas like the Aleutians, you'll see a whole bunch of coral and sponges living really close to each other, like in some of those pictures you saw. And a lot of that is determined by what type of substrate is there, like what the bottom type is like. But the Aleutians is definitely a hot spot there for lots of corals and sponge.
Is there, do you have any ideas why that might be?
I know that the depth is a factor, like how deep it is, as well as what the bottom type is. I mean, just because the sponges tend to want to live on more hard surfaces. So since there's all these different types of bottom type, that tends to predict where they're going to be more so.
Great. Ronan had a question about sponges. He was asking, are sponges the best kind of filter feeder in the ocean? Are they more efficient at filter feeding than a lot of others?
You know, I don't know that I can answer that question. A lot of animals filter feed in different ways, but there's certainly a lot of them. They move a lot of water through them. So I don't know if they're the best, though. I'm not sure who wins.
Yeah, maybe they have different categories of filter feed, because I know that some filter feeders are much more active. They have little tentacles that kind of move the water through, and I got the impression that sponges are more passive filter feeders where the water comes through, but maybe that's not true. Okay, so I know that we have a lot more to get through, so maybe we will switch to Pam, and I will switch the presenter over to her so she can get ready. But thank you, Vanessa, that was really interesting. Okay, Pam, so you have your presenter mode on. There you go.
Okay, hi, welcome. It's good to be here again. We were here last year about the same time. So my name is Pam Goddard, and I'm gonna tell you a little bit about myself before I tell you about our research. I grew up on the East Coast, and as a young child, I was passionate about horses, but also the ocean. When I went to college, I focused on plants. So I wasn't focusing on either one of those really. Then after college, I drove to Alaska with a good friend of mine. Well, I have some pictures here, sorry. I'm a little distracted today. So I drove to Alaska and decided I wanted to stay, and I became a foreign fisheries observer on the foreign vessels, Russian and Japanese vessels off the coast of Alaska, which led to a job with the Alaska Fisheries Science Center eventually. And I did take some time off in there to stay home and raise my kids. And at that time I started my own company called SLASA, which was science education and outreach. And then eventually in 2014, I joined the Alaska Coral and Sponge Initiative. So the Alaska Fisheries Coral and Sponge Initiative has, I'm going to talk to you today about our summer research, tools for surveying the deep, the Alaska Fishery Science Center technology and development team, and our data collection. This summer, we have two research cruises going out in the Southeast and Gulf of Alaska, and no, we will not be going on these beautiful research or these beautiful cruise vessels that come into Juneau and Alaska. We will be going out on the lovely RV Solstice from Alaska Department of Fish and Game, and the research vessel Volstead with the survey vessels of Alaska. Our first cruise will be starting in Elfin Cove in June here coming up in a couple of weeks, and we're going to go out to Fairweather Ground and collect coral growth plate, and they're also called ARMS, which is this down here, which stands for artificial reef monitoring structures, and I'll tell you more about those. So we're going to retrieve some old plates that were put down a couple years ago, and this is what they looked like when they were made by our lab in Juneau. And here's what they look like when they put them down onto the seafloor on Fairweather Ground. And what we're looking for is what coral actually settles on these plates when they settle out of their plankton stage. After we retrieve, or hopefully after we retrieve those four plates, we're going to set down four new ones. And this is what the new ones look like. And this circle on the bottom is actually a piece of bronze that hopefully will hold them down so that they won't float away in the strong currents out there in the Gulf of Alaska. Our second cruise is called a coral and sponge model validation cruise, and we are going to go out. We'll start in Homer, and then we're going to try to connect these dots as best as possible and collect sample at each one of these dots. The red dots are the highest priority, and then we'll hit the orange ones. We're hoping to sample at 300 places this summer. We'll go into head down to Southeast, go back to Yakutat where we change crew. From Yakutat, we'll head west, and then we go back to Homer, and we'll end in Homer mid-July. So how do we survey the deep sea? What tools do we use? This summer, like I said, we're gonna be going out and taking 300 samples in 28 days. That's a lot of samples to collect of coral and sponges in the deep sea. And how do you think we collect those samples? Vanessa gave you a bit of a hint before.
So for those of you in the audience, if you have any ideas of how Pam and Vanessa will be collecting samples from their stations that they'll be doing, please write it into the question box and we'll see what ideas people come up with. In the meantime, while we're waiting for people to put in their ideas, Pam, I did have a question about those plates that you showed that were made in Juneau that you were going to put down, that were put down previously. There was a question of what are those plates, what were those plates made of? You mentioned really that the new ones have bronze, but yeah.
So the new ones are plastic with bronze on the bottom. The old ones were stone. So we didn't have to add weights to the bottom of them. They were just these big pieces of stone, and there were four of them that were put together in a framework. And they just, we set them down on the bottom of the ocean. Yeah, so they were heavy themselves.
Right, so, and the new ones are metal, you said?
The new ones are plastic, so those gray, I can go back if you want and show you, those gray plates, let's see. Those there, those individual plates are actually a very thick plastic, and then they have these little spacers in between. And then this is the very bottom. We had to add a piece of bronze to the bottom so that they wouldn't float away.
Got it.
And the loop at the top, is actually so we have something to hold on to when we lower it down.
Got it. Wow, that'll be interesting to see what it looks like when you pull them up. So to get back to your question about what kind of tools would you use, we've got a lot of ideas here. So Linda is saying remotely operated vehicle, Michelle is saying scuba divers, Ronan is saying using an ROV, so we've got two votes for ROVs there, and Grace is wondering whether you use trawling to find to get samples of corals and sponges.
Those are all great, great ideas. And yes, you are all right. We do use scuba. Scuba tends to provide some pretty detailed work because you can go down there and you can actually write notes and things like that. It tends to be inshore only. It has to be fairly shallow. Like Vanessa said before, it's limited to how deep the human body can go in the ocean. And some of these corals we're looking at are down to hundreds and hundreds of meters, so thousands and thousands of feet. We also use submersibles, which Vanessa showed you a picture of earlier. These submersibles are great. They go deeper than scuba, obviously. They can collect samples. They have little arms on them where you can actually collect samples and bring them back. They collect videos and photos from when you go down. They can be kind of expensive to run. And they also make noise and have lights, which if you're studying fish, can alter the fish's behavior. Remotely operated vehicles, some people said ROVs or remotely operated vehicles. Absolutely, we do use them to study corals and sponges. They take great images. They're real time, which means you can actually see what the ROV is seeing up on the vessel. They can go very deep into the deep sea. They also can collect samples. They can do fairly long dives, like up to hours long. These tend to be more expensive. You need a specific ship to deploy these off of that has the technology to monitor the ROVs and stay attached. And again, they have light and noise, which we've discovered can sometimes change the fish's behavior.
So we did have a couple of questions actually going back to the plates. Carol was wondering how heavy are those plates? And I guess, you know, how heavy are the stone plates, and then how heavy are the plastic plates that you had to put the bronze on?
So I think the plastic plates, and we had this number, and I'm not sure I'm going to get it right off the top of my head. The plastic plates are about 37 pounds, and I think the stone plates were 40, but I might be wrong, so don't quote me on that. So they're, you know, they're not incredibly heavy, but hopefully heavy enough that they won't get moved by currents.
So the question, one of the questions was about the bronze disc that you put on the bottom to weight it down. Were you having problems with the stone plates that they were getting tumbled? Is that why you put the bronze on the new plates?
That's a really good question. So the stone plates were ones that we created at our center years ago. And the newer plates, which are called ARMS, artificial reef monitoring systems, are more of a standardized way of monitoring coral growth. Lots of different research organizations are using these now, these plastic plates, this design that we have decided to use this year. And the bronze for us, because we're setting these in areas in the deep sea with high currents, we had to figure out a way to to anchor ours because we can't actually go down and anchor it to something. So we had to add weight to it. And that's a scrap piece of bronze that came out, I believe, out of an old ship or something like that.
And you had shown that handle that's on top of the plastic ones. Mm-hmm. Is that what you use to retrieve the plates?
Yes. So that handle is actually going to have some line attached to it and a plastic bucket lid. And the plastic bucket lid we're using because it can be picked up by the vessel when we're looking for it later on when we come back to look for it. And yes, that arm that is attached to the top, hopefully we'll be able to use, and we have a remotely operated vehicle that can go down and attach something to it so that we can then pull it up. Of course, this is a pilot project. We're sort of, this summer, we're going out to learn how to do all of this and make sure it's possible.
So Louisa was wondering, how long do the plates stay on the bottom of the ocean? So that first set of plates that you showed, the ones that were stone, they've been down for a year, did you say?
They've been down for 8 years.
Oh, wow. Eight years.
Yeah. But and the so new that, ones will be down for a year.
Oh, I see. That's where I got the year from. So, So will you be able to compare? Will you be bringing them up every year? Or is it just you want to see how much has started during that first year?
Good question. So the new ones, we have funding to go back and collect those for at least 2 more years.
Well, that's really interesting. I had no idea that the other ones had been down there for 8 years. I would imagine that there'd be a lot of growth. Linda was also wondering whether there is the possibility of placing a camera trap on the plates so that you could get pictures of fish that are coming around the coral that are gathering on the plates.
That is a great idea, putting a camera out there. And we have not done that, and that is not in our plan. It's a fairly remote area, and getting the camera back and getting the images off of it. And that's just not something that's part of our program, but that is a great idea.
So one more question about the plates. Do you put them back down after you get done bringing them up and reviewing them, or do you just put down a new one each time?
That's a really good question. At this point, I am not the PI on this project, but I believe Rhianne will be putting down new plates.
Great. Okay, I know you have another big, interesting section to go through, so I will let you go. We'll hold on to the rest of our questions, and we'll go ahead with your next section.
Okay, great. So at the Alaska Fisheries Science Center, we have a technology and development team, and they have developed a very specific camera for our habitat surveys. Our team is comprised of Rick Towler and Cressimer Williams. It's a very small team, and they have been supported by Chris Ruper, who was a former member of our Coral and Sponge initiative. And there are bios on all three of these researchers at the end of the presentation, and I won't go into it, but they each wrote a little bit of information about how they became involved in what they're doing and sort of what their background is.
I think that it's funny that all of the pictures that you showed of them, they're looking down at their work. They're so engaged in what they're doing, they can't even look up.
They are very hard at work. All right, so the cameras that we use and for our work have gone through many, many iterations, and they started with Cressimer and Rick trying to decide if they could use cameras to look at fish passing into a net. So they wanted to be able to identify and count fish passing into a research net. And these are just different examples of what the cameras looked like over the years until they finally came up with what we're using for our survey this summer. And it's called a stereo, meaning two cameras, drop camera system. And this system is about 3 feet tall and 3 feet wide and 20 inches tall. So it's not very big. These two lenses here are the cameras, and then on the side are strobe lights, and these lights flash on and off. And like I was talking about before, the subs and ROVs can make noise as they go through the water. This has no motor. It's actually attached to a cable and is towed or drifted through the water, and then the strobe lights flash on and off, so it's not a constant light. Inside, this is the cameras. These are the two cameras that are inside this frame. I'm sorry, I'm lost for words here today. These cameras are actually really small. They fit in the palm of your hand. They're about the size of a marshmallow. That's how big they are. These cameras go inside this waterproof housing that can go down to 800 meters. Then they're put in the frame and they're lowered over the side of the vessel. Now, the advantage of this system over the ROVs and the submersibles is that they do fairly short dives. We'll be sending them down for 15 minutes. We can collect many, many, many samples. So we're hoping to collect 300 samples this summer in 28 days. It's fairly inexpensive. We can get measurements of the fish and the coral and sponges that we're looking at. We can also identify them and get measurements of them. And this, the depth limit on this, like I said, is 800 meters, which is about half a mile or 2,600 feet, which is pretty good. And then once we've collected all these samples, and by samples, I mean these videos or images, we run it through a software. And this software was actually also written by Cressimer and Rick. So they wrote a software program that would analyze the images that came back from their camera system. This software allows us to identify each individual. We can measure them. We can say what the substrate is. It's a pretty complex, and it's all exported into a database for us. So the data collected from these images is we mark and identify every coral, sponge, and fish. We measure the fish length and the coral height. We identify the substrate or what they grow on. Each one is 15 minutes, and we collect 900 pictures in those 15 minutes. And overall, we hope to collect 270,000 pictures this summer. Can you guess how many coral and sponges we counted so far in the two surveys that Vanessa was talking to you about in the Bering Sea and the Aleutian Islands? We went through all of those images and we counted up the corals and sponges. Anybody have an idea? 50,000, 75,000, 100,000, 300,000, or 500,000? What do you think?
So give your best guess as to how many corals and sponges Pam and Vanessa have counted on those videos. And actually, I was going to ask, as while we're waiting for the answers to come in on that, is why do you record the substrate or what the coral and sponge is attached to?
That's a really good question. And like Vanessa was saying before, corals and sponges are sessile, and so they like to attach to substrate that is fairly hard, so rocks or bedrock. And so we're looking at, are different species growing on different substrates, or are there more sponges on certain substrates than others? So it just helps us define the habitat of where the coral and sponge grow.
Right. So what's more important to different species? So we are having a lot of guesses pouring in here. We've got Carol and Ronan saying 300,000. Linda says 500,000. Laura says 300,000. Alice and Paul are saying 500,000. Michael is saying 300,000. So it seems to be about evenly split between 300,000 and 500,000. Louisa is saying 50,000. Michelle is saying 500,000. So everybody's going high on this one.
All right. Well, good. So in the Bering Sea, we counted, we looked at 225,000 pictures, and we counted 70,000 sponge and corals, and it was mostly sponges. And then in the Aleutian Islands, we looked at, so less pictures, we looked at 190,000 pictures, about 191, and we counted 325,000 corals and sponges, and it was about half and half. So you can see from that, we counted less pictures, we looked at less pictures and counted over three times as many corals and sponges in the Aleutian Islands. It is a very, very rich habitat for corals and sponges.
Right.
So what has Alaska done to protect its coral and sponge habitat? Alaska has created these bottom trawl fishing restrictions. So any area in gray on this map is where there are some sort of restrictions in place for bottom trawl fishing. And also Alaska has set outside some areas where no fishing is allowed to protect coral and sponge habitat. And there are also some seamounts off the off in the deeper waters that are protected from fishing as well.
So now that actually gets back to what Vanessa was talking about in terms of threats to corals and sponges, in that fishing nets are a big threat to coral and sponge in their habitat. So by having areas where you can't fish, which are these no fishing zones, and areas where there's limitations on the bottom trawl fishing that you can do, those are measures that can help prevent damage to corals from those nets.
That's correct. And so we have limited, so in these zones, it's all fishing. So you can't even long line or do any type of fishing in these zones on this page. Whereas in the previous page, this is for bottom trawling. So bottom trawling can be pretty destructive for coral and sponge habitat, but we also see, long line gear, other types of fishing gear down there as well. So yes, fishing in general can be bad for coral and sponge habitat. So these two slides are slides, and I'm not going to read them off, but these are biographies of the technology and development team, and they're actually pretty fun to read about how they ended up where they ended up. But that's all. Thank you. Any questions?
And for those of you who are interested in the biographies of our technology team, you can go back to, once we get the recording up on our website, you can go back and freeze frame on the biographies and read them, because I think that there's some pretty interesting stuff there.
Yes.
So we have a couple of questions. I know we have one more section with Hannah, so I want to be mindful of our time. But Ronan was wondering about, you'd mentioned with the cameras that because they are not motorized and they don't have the lights are strobe lights, so they're not on all the time, they minimize the disturbance to the behavior of fish that you were talking about with ROVs. So Ronan was wondering, could ROVs have some sort of device to absorb the sound of the motor, making them quieter and less disturbing?
That is a really, really good question. And I don't know enough about ROVs to answer that question, but I am sure that is out there. I know they've done a lot of research on sound and fish behavior. It's something I could look into for you, or you could look up on the internet, but it is a really good question.
I'm sure that's one of the engineering questions that ROV makers are looking at, because that would make them more useful as research instruments for sure.
Yes.
One last question before we move on to Hannah's section. So Carol was wondering, what do you do with the old plates that you pick up? Do they get cleaned off and put back down, or do they just kind of get stored?
So that's a good question. The stone plates that are coming up that we're collecting that have been down there for 8 years are just going to get recycled in the landfill, I think. We're not going to use those again, basically. The stone will go to use somewhere else. And the arms plates, this is our first time putting them out. And in a year from now, I know what that we'll do is we'll scrape off of what's on there. And whether they can be put back down or not, yes, eventually they will get recycled. Whether they get put back down again right away, that I'm not sure.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Pam. And I will now make Hannah the presenter. And I appreciate the time and the information that you've given us.
Thanks.
Hi, everyone. Thank you guys so much all for being here. I'm really honored to have the chance to speak with you all today. Before I talk about some of my experiences with my internship, I just wanted to introduce myself. So my name is Hannah Miller.
And Hannah, we are seeing a blank screen for your presenter here.
Oh, sorry about that. Let me try. Let's see.
Oh, there we go.
Do you see this? Okay, perfect.
Yeah,
sorry.
Fine. Yeah.
Okay, great. So yeah, I just wanted to introduce myself. So my name is Hannah Miller, and I'm coming to you guys from Atlanta, Georgia. But I grew up on the banks of the Hudson River in New York, where I spent a lot of my time swimming and fishing and crabbing and kayaking with friends and family. So during school, I was also on my school and club swim team, and I spent a lot of time in my free time reading and writing short stories about marine biology, since I was pretty far from the ocean. And these hobbies really helped me develop an equal passion for marine ecology and for writing. I just graduated from Emory University in Atlanta as an environmental science major and a creative writing major. And even though my school is landlocked, it hasn't stopped me from a lot of my different passions, like getting my PADI scuba certification and doing lake water research and going on trips with my university to cool places like the Bahamas to feel connected to marine environments. And in a few weeks, I'm actually moving to California to be a marine science teacher. But there's a whole world of jobs and learning opportunities that I have yet to explore, but I wanted to share some of what I've learned with you all today. So I really love school and learning, but outside of the classroom, I've spent this year working with NOAA Fisheries DeepSea Coral Research and Technology Program with my two mentors, Heather and Danny. And I just sort of wanted to take today to chat with you guys about finding research and internship opportunities so that you too can make your goals of working in marine science a reality. And it's possible to intersect your own unique interests. So I started out in NOAA as an intern, which is a student that works with a company or an organization part-time. And that started this past summer with the NOAA Ocean Exploration Office. And because of my background in writing and the hard sciences, I got to work with the communications and the science team. And I actually ended up writing about 15 different articles about the biology and technology that was found and was used during the summer ocean exploration expeditions. Because I was writing so many articles and doing research on material that I was pretty unfamiliar with, I got to interview a bunch of NOAA scientists, and I ended up talking to over 40 experts and employees, and many of them were people that I reached out to on my own, doing something called cold calling. So I'm curious, do any of you guys know what cold calling is?
So if anybody knows what cold calling is, you want to put it into your into the chat box. Michael says yes, but so if you want to know, if you want to let people know what you think it is, some folks are saying that it's calling somebody that you don't know. Let's see, there's somebody else who's asking, Michelle is saying that you have no introduction to somebody. Louisa is saying calling someone you have no connection to. So is that what you mean by cold calling, and not cold calling in a cold temperature or cold environment?
Right. Yeah. Even though that is a good guess. Yes, you guys are all correct. Cold calling is basically reaching out to people on a whim that you don't really have an introduction to, just to speak with them or hear from them. And I personally decided to reach out to as many people as possible through this cold calling and cold emailing technique so that I could hear about their careers to kind of inspire my own. And that's why I got connected with my current internship leader, Heather. I really liked her professional background, and I clicked with her when we met virtually. So I emailed her towards the end of my summer internship and just asked to volunteer with her. And she accepted me on her team, and I now work with the DeepSea Coral Office. So cold calling and cold emailing can take a lot of practice. It takes time and it takes research, and it can be a little bit uncomfortable at the beginning. And it's important to kind of get to know a little bit about the person you're talking to and what they're involved in. But even though it's a bit scary, it's a great way of kind of expanding your own network and getting involved and learning a little bit more about whatever research community you're interested in. So you might be asking yourself, what exactly does an intern do? And that can be very different for any program, like if you're volunteering or if you're getting paid, or whether it's in person or virtual. But at the end of the day, interns are really there to help the organization accomplish their goals. And internships are there to teach students about different careers. So for my specific internship with the DeepSea Coral Research and Technology Program, I've gotten to interview scientists from all around the world and write website articles for NOAA on discoveries ranging from queen snapperfish to sponges that cure cancer in Alaska. I've also gotten to read research articles and work with data to make maps. Internships are really all about trying new things. And for me, those things were learning how to combine my love for writing with my love for marine biology. being a part of a team is also a really big part of internships. From calling into live calls during dive expeditions to take notes for my internship mentors when they couldn't be there for specific meetings, I got to learn so much about how expeditions are chartered and how marine samples are collected, and how our oceans are just explored each and every single day. Like I said before, I'm also a full-time student at Emory, so balancing school and internships can definitely be a bit difficult, which is why a lot of students wait until their senior year to do both, like I did. But if it's work you're interested in, it's absolutely worth it. What's key to remember, though, is that once you commit to an opportunity, it's important to follow through. So things aren't always easy at the beginning, nor are they always super interesting at the beginning, and the learning takes time. So it's important that you don't give up on yourself or your commitments or your teammates. And it's important to honor your commitments and try out as many as possible so that you can kind of find your own path of interest. So now you might be thinking, wow, this is great. Like, how do I become an intern? And the answer is really that it all starts right in your own backyard. Career goals and desires for you might be changing all the time, and that's totally normal. For me personally, I grew up on the Hudson River and I became really interested in marine science, but it wasn't until I got to college and started studying water chemistry that I realized chemistry isn't exactly my strong suit and I'm a lot more interested in biology. So I took advantage of research and educational opportunities that were at my disposal in college, and that's kind of helped me carve this path. But you don't need to be in college to be a researcher. Just going into your backyards and coming up with your own research questions, talking to your teachers at school about why they do what they do, ask if you can shadow them when they do paperwork, take classes in high school that you think might line up with your goals, like AP classes, or if possible doing summer programs that are part of your niche interest. There are also tons of free resources out there that can connect you with more knowledge. And being curious is one of the most important qualities to have as an intern and just an explorer in general. So student webinars, just like this one, are all great ways for you to expand your own knowledge and meet people and scientists who you can talk to and ask questions. And reading books and magazines at the library is also a great accessible way to kind of keep that motivation. As you start going to college, it's important to have a diverse academic background. So I moved pretty far from home, from New York to Georgia, and I love my school, but I found it kind of difficult to be connected to the marine science community at this landlocked institution. So I took advantage of all the classes that could connect me to marine science that were offered to me. And I even assumed a research position with my school's environmental science lab. And I found that it doesn't really matter what you study or what resources are immediately at your disposal. What matters is your drive and your commitment to using what you have around you. You'll gain a lot of intangible skills from the classes that you take. So for example, my calculus class taught me a lot about teamwork. My biology class taught me how to come up with strong research questions. My tropical environments class taught me how to keep scientific journals and records for me to come back to later. And all of my writing classes have taught me about public speaking and sharing my ideas. And all these lessons have worked together to push me closer to my goals. And those goals don't necessarily have to be marine science. The most important lesson that I really want to share with you is that there are so many ways to be a marine scientist. And science fields need more than just biologists. We need writers and artists and physicists and engineers and coders and so much more. I remember when I was younger, I really loved writing books and stories, but I felt that I had to choose between my love for creative writing and my love for the ocean. But from my internships and meeting different science communicators, I learned that it's possible to combine those two interests into one position. And I'm really grateful for my background as a scientist and as a writer because it allows me to understand the science and then communicate that with broader audiences. So at the end of the day, whether you want to be a marine biologist or an astronaut or a painter, what's really important is to stay curious and know that the world is yours to kind of connect with and explore. So I'd love to answer any questions you guys might have for me. And yeah, thank you so much for having me today.
Thank you so much, Hannah. That is a tremendous amount of information, and we really appreciate you putting all that together. And I think one of the things that I really appreciated you saying is that marine science needs all people of all sorts of backgrounds, and that you can combine your interests to find yourself doing something that combines all of those interests. So I think that that's a really valuable question for everyone. So if you have any questions for Hannah, please put them in the question box. In the meantime, I think that if we can go to the next slide, I wanted to bring your attention to the Coral and Sponge websites that Vanessa and Pam and Hannah have talked about here. And so if you're interested in following up on information about corals and sponges, then you can come to this slide and get these websites. One of the questions that I had wanted to ask all three of you, so Hannah and Pam and Vanessa, if you guys could put if Pam and Vanessa can put your cameras back on, one of the things that I had wanted to ask you guys was if you had any advice that you would like to give the students in our audience, what piece of advice would you give them based on, you know, your work that you've done so far and what you've experienced? And because Hannah just went, I'm going to have her go first.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great question. I think my advice is just kind of to not be discouraged by the fact that science might seem sort of like just a one-sided field. There's a lot of different aspects that go into it, kind of like I was just saying, needing artists and needing communicators. There's a lot of different ways for you to kind of work your way into this community and just kind of taking advantage of whatever opportunities you might have, whether you're in middle school or high school or college or beyond. It's easy to kind of find free resources to get you connected to that kind of knowledge, and then just not being afraid to reach out to people, whether it be through webinars like this or online. Just sort of putting yourself out there is a really strong piece of advice that I have for you guys.
Great. Thank you, Hannah. Pam, what would you say for our students in the audience?
I would agree with everything Hannah just said. And I would also say, don't be afraid to make mistakes and be persistent. You know, I grew up in pretty much landlocked Connecticut and Virginia and spent some summers on the coast and really liked the ocean, but the college I went to didn't have a marine biology program. So I studied plants, but I figured out a way to study a marine plant. And then, you know, after college, I interviewed for a lot of jobs and I just didn't want to be in a lab or somewhere else. And I decided to drive to Alaska and found a job as a fisheries observer. And that just opened all sorts of doors for me. But I had to be really persistent and I had to like accept the fact that I was going to make mistakes and that it was okay to make mistakes and to just keep going. And also, you know, there are all sorts of people in the marine science field, and some of us have it's harder for us to learn than others. I have dyslexia and I was diagnosed, you know, in elementary school, so learning for me took a lot of extra effort and tutors and things like that, and you know, sometimes I would have to study twice as hard as the person sitting next to me, but I knew what I wanted and it was worth the extra effort.
Great, thanks so much, Pam. Vanessa, what kind of advice would you have for our students?
I would say maybe to offer help or assistance when you have an opportunity to, and not everybody's going to need it, but it can open doors to new experiences and give you an opportunity to try new things. And I agree with all the things that Hannah and Pam said for sure, but being willing to try new things for sure.
Great. Well, thank you guys. Thanks, Hannah, Pam, and Vanessa, so much for sharing your knowledge and your experiences with us. We really appreciate it. And this is our last NOAA Live Alaska webinar for the 2021-22 school year. So we're hoping to start up again in the fall. But in the meantime, for our audience, please stay tuned and we will be sending out notices when we start up again. And for now, thank you so much for joining us on all of our webinars this season. And thanks to Pam and Vanessa and Hannah for sharing their research and their knowledge with us. Really appreciate it. And I hope everybody has a great summer. Bye-bye.